Thank you, choir. We walk by faith and you sing by faith. And we appreciate your words and your music and the fact that you're here. I know the choir, like the rest of the staff, has been decimated by the flu, y'all. And, you know, and still they lift up their voices in praise and song, and we are so grateful. The Lord gets us through. The Lord gets us through, Keith. And that's what this sermon is about today. But before we get into it, I gave you homework last week. I'm ready to take it up now, so if you'd like to, I don't see any of y'all rushing forward. Okay, Sharon Swink has hers, that's good. All right, so in case I need to remind you, and for those of you who are here today and weren't here last week, we're writing our own Psalm 111, which is we're writing God's resume. We're writing a resume for God. Okay, that's Psalm 111. Psalm 112 was writing our own resume. Spiritual autobiography is another way to put it. And then the third, Psalm 113, is writing the church's resume. All right, so if you don't have it today, that's okay. You have all the time in the world to get to it. Or maybe not. Which is what our scripture is encouraging us to think about today. So let's go into this wonderful text from the prophet Isaiah and share together in a word of prayer. Lord, may the words of my mouth that you have put upon paper and in our hearts, and the meditations and reflections that each one of us bring to your word, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So this morning's text that was so beautifully read today by Reverend Sherry, thank you, Sherry. It was written by the prophet Isaiah, and he wrote it during a period of history when the people of Judah, the Hebrew people, still believed that they were walking in the light of God. And while it was true that Israel still staked claim that they were God's chosen people, while Judah still felt that they had been a part of the chosen folk, perhaps we can see, as we read through the rest of the scripture, that they may have been so blinded by the light of their own self-importance that they were unable to see that they themselves were dimming the light of God's presence in the world through bad behavior and sinful choices. In his youth, Isaiah had visions. He was one of those guys called a prophet. He's the one who had the binoculars, if Allison were here, who could see into the future. And when he was young, he had this vision, and he shared it with the people. And he said, "The people who have walked in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned." It was such a beautiful gift that Isaiah gave to his people. And we in the 21st century, Christians, we hear another part of that scripture later in chapter 9 from our own perspective, when Isaiah said, "For unto us a child is born, to us a child is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder." And we know that that was a vision that came to fruition. And we celebrate that through the life and gift of Jesus Christ. But that vision was for a time much further off than when Isaiah first uttered those words. Because before that vision could be fully realized, Isaiah's people would have to endure some very dark days. Arriving sooner than later was a period known as the exile, about which Isaiah had been increasingly warning his kinfolk that would be coming upon them if they did not change their ways. And the first 39 chapters of Isaiah build up to a climax of foreshadowing. And I'd like for us to read about that final moment in that first section of Isaiah. If you'll turn in your Bibles to page 667 in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew Scriptures, 667, let's just hear a little bit about what happens right before we hear our morning text today. 667. We're looking at chapter 39. Chapter 39 of Isaiah. Just a little background. Hezekiah is the 12th king of Judah. At this time, the people of Israel, the sons and daughters of Abraham, had split into two kingdoms, Israel and Judah. And Hezekiah was the 12th king of Judah. And he had come in, he was a good guy. He was righteous in heart. And during the early part of his reign, he was really trying to fix the mess that kings before him, including his father Ahaz, had created in the kingdom of Judah. And Hezekiah was finally getting things together, finally getting his nation back on track, when a lapse in judgment occurred and a relapse of spiritual health descended upon Judah. Now, if you look at the title of chapter 38 in your Bible, look at the title of chapter 38. You'll see there that Hezekiah had an illness. It may have been the flu. Who knows? Maybe they're going through it as bad as we are. All right, but he had gotten sick and almost unto the point of death. But he recovered. And when news of his recovery made its way known throughout the kingdoms around that part of the world, of that part of the Middle East, there were envoys sent from the country, the nation of Babylon, just to bring greetings and well wishes, supposedly, to Hezekiah. Chapter 39 tells about that. And let's start, if you look at verse 3, and read with me there. It starts in verse 3 of chapter 39. Then the prophet Isaiah came to King Hezekiah and said to him, "What did these men say? From where did they come to you?" And Hezekiah answered, "They've come to me from the far country, from Babylon." And Isaiah said, "What have they seen in your house?" And Hezekiah answered, "They've seen it all. They've seen all that's in my house. There is nothing in my storehouses that I did not show them." Then Isaiah said to Hezekiah, "Hear the word of the Lord of hosts. Days are coming when all that is in your house and that which your ancestors have stored up until this day shall be carried to Babylon. Nothing shall be left, says the Lord. Some of your own sons who are born to you shall be taken away, and they shall be eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon." Okay, then this is the weird statement here. Then Hezekiah said to Isaiah, "The word of the Lord that you have spoken is good." For he thought to himself, "There will be peace and security in my day." Okay, so we hear this, and if we look at the history of the Judean people, there was peace and security in Hezekiah's day, to be sure. But it was only a few decades later that the Babylonians remembered what they had seen in the palace of Judah, all that was in the storehouses, all the wealth that was kept in the back rooms. And they set upon the nation when once again the nation of Judah was ruled by a weak and corrupt leader. For you see, Hezekiah had fallen into the same self-focused and short-sighted trap that many generations of us slip into. That is, while ensuring the good life for ourselves and for our generation, we don't have the foresight to think about the fallout of our decisions for future generations. For in the years following Hezekiah's reign, there was no peace, no security for the people of Judah. Far from it. There was violence and destruction. There was devastation and a diaspora that scattered the people of Judea all over the Middle East. When chapter 40 picks up, that beautiful text that Sherry read today, when chapter 40 picks up, some scholars suggest that the time that has lapsed between those words we just read in chapter 39 is about 50 to 100 years. Isaiah had been silent for 50 to 100 years. And during that time, horrible things had happened to the people. So that Isaiah's first utterance to his people is this: "Comfort, comfort, O my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins." After many, many years of silence, the Lord speaks again. And it is a tender word of comfort to a people who have walked in deep darkness for many years, who had been torn away from all that they loved, all that was familiar, all that was home. And during this time of exile, the people had begun to question if there really was a God. It's understandable that the questions arose, isn't it? Perhaps you all might understand that. When you think about periods in your own life where you have wandered, when you have felt separated from God, when you have felt particularly in a period of darkness, perhaps you've asked, "Are you there, God? Are you for real, God?" Perhaps the most poignantly written example of one who questioned that God's very existence was an author, mid-century writer, by the name of Elie Wiesel, who was a young man imprisoned in Auschwitz in Buchenwald, two of the worst Nazi concentration camps. Wiesel had been studying to be a rabbi when he was swept up into what we now know of as the Holocaust. And he recounts one particularly haunting story. Three prisoners, two men and a young boy, were to be hanged in front of the whole group. The men died instantly, but the young boy took time to die. And at one point, they were all made to file past the gallows, and someone in the crowd cried out, "For God's sake, where is God?" And Wiesel said he heard a voice within him saying, "Well, where is he? This is where he is, hanging from the gallows." Many Christians who have heard Wiesel's words as obvious parallels to our belief think that he was saying that God is with us in our suffering. Just as Jesus died on a cross, so is God with us in all situations. But that is not what Wiesel meant. Wiesel meant that God was hanging from the gallows because God was dead. Or at least his faith in God was dead. And it's no accident that he entitled his book Night, for it was essentially a diary of his nightmare in the camps. For him, there was no light from God in which to walk. Now, I know this feels really depressing today, but I want to name that as we have been walking through this epiphany text of what it means to walk in the light of God, that at different times in our journeys, we may not be able to see the light of God, and we've got to name it, and we've got to say that it exists, and that even in the midst of that darkness, when we cannot see the light, that there are others who are helping us bring the light. Because I do think it is up to us to help bring that light. My heart was broken this past week to hear of the suicide of a young man named Mark Salling. He was a person I did not know personally, but I had gotten to know him, as we do those people on television who act and are in our living room on TV. I was a fan of his TV show. I called myself a gleek when I watched it. Anybody else understand what I mean when I say I was a gleek? Yeah, watching the TV show Glee. TV show's premise was about how high school outcasts found their voices and themselves when they joined the choir. That's true, right? When you join a choir, you find your voice, you find yourself, you've got community to be in. You see, Mark Salling played someone who at first wasn't in the Glee Club. He was a bad boy football player. Who hid his true love for singing, because he always made fun of the Glee Club members as nerds. But finally, one day he was punished. He got in trouble, and his punishment was to go sing in the Glee Club. And he found his passion and his new friends. What we didn't know while watching him on TV was that Mark was struggling with a dark side. It was recently reported that he was arrested for possessing child pornography. And perhaps it was the shame of that discovery that led him to commit suicide this past week. But what breaks my heart, y'all, is that he was one of us. He grew up right here in Dallas, homeschooled by Christian parents, and later attended Our Redeemer Lutheran for a while in elementary school. He graduated from Lake Highlands High School, y'all. How I wish he could have heard from someone the words from Isaiah this morning, that in the midst of his dark night of the soul, it could have been the light that helped him find his way home. Let's hear those words again that Sherry read, this time from the Message translation. Why would you ever complain, O Jacob, or whine, Israel, saying, God has lost track of me. He doesn't care what happens to me. Don't you know anything? Haven't you been listening? God doesn't come and go. God lasts. He's creator of all that you can see or imagine. He doesn't get tired out. He doesn't pause to catch his breath. He knows everything and everyone inside and out. And he energizes those who are tired. He gives strength to dropouts. Even young folk who tire and drop out. Even young folk in their prime who stumble and fall. But those who wait upon the Lord get fresh strength. They spread their wings and are able to soar like eagles. They run and they don't get tired. They walk and they don't lag behind. For you see, these words from Isaiah are testifying firsthand that those who feel mired in the quicksand of problems, those who feel stuck in the rut of despondency, those who have been quarantined for weeks and sometimes years upon end with the flu of the soul, that the Lord's healing hand is there to pull them up and out and on our feet again. And not only that, if we practice our patience and perseverance through those times, if we can just wait upon the Lord, We are promised that the Lord will lift us up like on the wings of eagles, and our spirits will soar once more. Now, friends, Isaiah was not just some self-help guru trying to make a quick buck with the power of positive thinking. He was someone who had been there and done that. He had suffered, he had struggled, and he persevered. And in the same vein as Isaiah, the Apostle Paul, who wrote many millennia later, wrote this to a community that needed to hear similar words in his second letter to the Corinthians when he said this: "We have this treasure in earthen vessels, jars of clay, to show that the transcendent power belongs to God and it isn't only on our shoulders. We are afflicted in every way, but we are not crushed. We're perplexed, but we're never driven to despair. We're persecuted, but we're not forsaken. We're struck down, but we're not destroyed. Always remembering that in our body is the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies." What Paul meant was that without crucifixion, there can be no resurrection. Without exile, there can be no homecoming. Without waiting on the Lord, there can be no lifting up on the wings of eagles. So, all Epiphany long, we've been talking about walking in the light, and I hope that if there are some of you who are here today who've been listening to these texts and reading the scriptures but haven't been connecting because you haven't been able to see the light, it's okay. Because this text was written for those of us in that place, and for those of us who may get to that place, this is written for the weary. It is written for those of us who are at our wit's end. And in this word, we've been given the Spirit of God that helps us to stand up. Even if we can't take that next step, perhaps the Lord will lift us up on wings as eagles into the light where we can see the best of what's next. This is the word of God, gift of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we celebrate the light of Christ's love for us, and especially in difficult times, and maybe, you know, somebody asked me if I wrote this because I'm feeling the midst of it. Well, yeah. I mean, the fact that Raymond, Janie, Keith, God bless you, Keith, for being here today, Daniel, all of our staff are in the midst of that flu season. It's been a tough time around here. Betty Hill and others of you. So yes, perhaps. But we all know that we carry one another on our prayers. And if you're looking for a church that carries one another in our prayers, in thanksgiving, in prayers for healing, and you're looking for a place to belong, know that this is a church home that's waiting for you. If you're ready to make your commitment to Christ through this place, please come forward as we all sing together hymn number 77, On Eagle's Wings. Let us all stand and sing.
Oh,
Amen and amen. You may be seated. As we gather our prayers together, knowing that God hears us and listens to us, all joys and concerns. And today is a day of joy in so many ways. And I'd like to first